morning, everybody. Welcome to Woodlawn Christian Church. A lot of exciting things have been happening over the course of the weekend. Just want to welcome you once again. If you're a visitor here, hey, we are glad you're here this morning. I've got so many awesome, exciting things that's been going on over the weekend. I definitely want to recognize two students this morning, Ben Vaughn. He's on the Taylor County Middle School football team, and they made it to the state semifinals there, and they played in Lexington, so they did an awesome job. Doing a great job there. And also one of our other students, Bennett Wise, he's in the Taylor County High School Marching Band, and they finished 6 out of 16 in their state competition there and got a distinguished rating, so that's awesome. As you know, this past couple weeks we've been gearing up for our fall festival. I just wanted to take a minute and just brag on all of you, because last night was a tremendous success. Things went very smoothly. Everybody worked together. I was just so proud of everybody and their hard work and all their effort. We had, guys, check this out. This is estimated from the people doing the registration. We had around 650 to 700 people come through this building last night. It was awesome, okay? So, hey, you can clap for that. That's very awesome. Yeah, that's awesome. So, I just want to recognize everybody. Thank you so much for all your hard work in the Fall Festival, from doing the games, doing registration, watching the bouncy houses, serving drinks, and just general, just being eyes and ears. Thank you. All your hard work has paid off. It was a tremendous success. So thank you once again for that. Also want to make mention of our Christian Church area-wide meeting for Thanksgiving. In the newsletter and bulletin, it said bring desserts. There's been a change on that. We are going to do finger foods and dessert. So finger foods and dessert. So that's going to be going on, I believe, the 21st or the 22nd of November of this new month that we're in. And then also, we are now switching gears to our kids' Christmas program. We're going to be doing a production called Christmas in Kid City. It's going to be a great production. Jamie is helping us take care of that and has an awesome night that's going to be planned for us. But if your child is in the play, we're going to be having practice starting Sunday evenings and Wednesday evenings. So be here. If your child wants to participate, that'd be great. We need you to be here on Sunday night and Wednesday night. That's a lot of announcements, guys. Hey, that's all right. But won't you join me in a time of prayer? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for this morning. Please be with us as we're coming here to worship you with our hearts, our minds, our souls, and give everything to you, God. Please be with us and help us focus on your message and your word this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, everybody, hey, let's stand up, grab the person next to you, and say, hey, I'm glad you're here. Welcome. Let's have a talk about it.
Born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my eyes and done and all the ways of man. Father in heaven, as we come around this table this morning, we're so thankful that you was willing to give your son to go to that cruel cross, and that he was willing to think of us and die in our place, that through his death, burial, and resurrection and our obedience, we do have a promise and a hope of eternal salvation in heaven. And Father, we're thankful for this memorial that he instituted himself before his death, that we might remember him. This loaf, this cup, represents his broken body and his shed blood. And we just pray, Father, that you will bless these emblems, bless each one that partakes this morning. For we ask these things in our Savior's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we count it a privilege to have just remembered your Son and the sacrifice that was made, how that strengthens each of us. We pray now that you'll be with us as we consider all the blessings you've sent our way, and just bless us as we attempt to give back a portion that can be used to strengthen your kingdom, and that can claim others to become a Christian. We just pray now that each of us will give lovingly, and that it'll be used in magnificent ways to honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's all be standing.
Truth in our brain, shine on me. Good morning. This morning's scripture is going to come from Mark chapter 10, 35 through 45. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. "Teacher," they said, "we want you to do this for us, whatever we ask." "What do you want me to do for you?" he asked. They replied, "Let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in glory." "You don't know what you're asking," Jesus said. "Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit at my right or my left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared." When the ten heard this, they came indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many."
Michael DeBear is the chef and the owner of the Kaiseroff restaurant in Montgomery, Texas. And he will probably soon go down in the Boss's Hall of Fame as one of the best employers that has ever been. Last year, he learned that one of his waitresses, a young 19-year-old lady by the name of Brittany Gilpin, had contracted cancer. And the cancer itself was the same kind of cancer that had just killed her dad 2 years earlier. Now, sadly, Brittany was unable to find a doctor that would take her case. And the reason was simple. She just didn't have health insurance. Now, she could have gotten insurance through the Affordable Care Act, and it would have covered some of her expenses. But those of you who have been through cancer, you already know that insurance doesn't even cover half of what you have to pay out of pocket. And even if she had insurance, she wouldn't be able to meet all of her expenses, so no doctor would take her on. Now, Mr. DeBear, he couldn't stand that. He had known Brittany since she was a tiny little girl, and he just could not stand the thought that she was going to die because she simply didn't have enough money to live. And so he made his decision, and he put his restaurant up for sale. And he said that when he sold the restaurant, whatever was left over after paying off his expenses would go toward her treatment. Now that is a selfless act. One, I think, that would be applauded by our friend, Sheriff Andy Taylor. Now, those of you who have been here, you know that for the last several weeks, we've been looking at some of the stories that were told on the Andy Griffith Show and comparing them to what the Bible has to say and learning from the two of them kind of put together, learning how to live better according to what the Bible says by kind of watching what Andy learns as he goes through the series on that particular television show. And, there was one particular occasion when he was asked to make a totally selfless sacrifice. And now, it didn't have the same drama as Mr. DeBear, but yet it still was kind of big. It wasn't a life and death thing, but it was a big deal for Andy because, you see, Andy had this fishing rod. And he'd had it for years. It was his lucky fishing rod. He took it everywhere he went fishing. He used this particular rod. In fact, he gave it a name. It was Eagle Eye Annie. And he always knew he was going to have good luck when he used old Eagle Eye Annie out on the lake or the pond or whatever. And then the Mayor Stoner, he found out about it. He decided he wanted that rod. So he started offering Andy money, but Andy would always turn him down, said, "There is no way, no possibility I'm ever going to part with this fishing rod. It gives me too much pleasure. There's no amount of money that I'll sell it for because it gives me too much pleasure and happiness." And then Aunt B's birthday came around. And she had her heart set on this bed jacket, and Andy finds out about it. She had seen it in the window of the store. His bed jacket's kind of like a real frilly robe, and she wanted it more than anything, and he wanted to get it for her. But the sad thing is that there was only one in the whole town, and Mayor Stoner had bought it the night before to give it to his wife as a coming home present after she'd been gone all week long. And so, on the morning of Aunt Bay's birthday, very early, this is what happened.
Now, what you say, Mayor? I'd be much obliged to you if you'd let me buy it off of you.
Well, this seems to be pretty important to you.
You better know it is.
Well, maybe we can work something out. Perhaps you've heard the old expression, one hand washes the other?
Yes.
Maybe we can make us a mutual deal. I'll sell something to you. You sell something to me.
Like what?
Like your fishing rod.
My what?
Give you $15 for it. You want the bed jacket? I want the fishing rod. What do you say?
I'm sorry I had to run out, Aunt B, it being your birthday and all.
What?
Well, you run out so fast a while ago, you didn't get a chance to look at number 3.
Oh.
I figured you'd have had it open by now.
Oh, my goodness.
Figured it'd be a kind of a sensible present to get. We could get some cool evenings. It's a whole lot cheaper than putting in a whole new furnace.
Andy, you really shouldn't have.
Well, now, if you'd rather, you can swap it in for a baseball cap.
Oh, no! Oh, I must call Clara. Oh, hello? Hello? Sarah? Would you get me Clara Johnson, please? Andy, you shouldn't. Oh, what do you think
I'm... If we're going fishing, Paul, we better hurry.
Mm-hmm. I'll show it to you.
Well, now, there's just one thing.
Paul,
well, it's more beautiful.
It's not here.
It's in the store.
I sold it to the mayor.
You sold it?
Big box on the table. And I...
But you said you never sell it.
No, not quite. I said I kept it because it gave me so much enjoyment and that I wouldn't sell it for money. And I didn't sell it for money. I just kind of swapped it for a different kind of enjoyment. So old Eagle Eye Annie's doing just what she did before. Even right now, she's giving me pleasure. Real heartwarming pleasure.
Isn't that wonderful? And you know, the color is just right for me. I just don't know when I've ever had such a nice birthday.
And all God's children said, "Oh, yeah, indeed." He traded his favorite fishing rod in for a bed jacket. And I think Jesus applauds that kind of thing. I think Jesus applauded Michael DeBeer when he sold his restaurant to take care of someone else in need. Because, you see, Christ spent half of his ministry just telling people to do stuff just like that. He spent half of his ministry telling his disciples and his followers that the kind of life that really makes a difference in this world is the kind of life that says, I don't care about me as much as I care about others. I am willing to give up what I need, what I think that I want, in order to meet the needs, to meet the wants, to meet the desires, to meet the people where they are. Because Jesus says that's the kind of life that shows love. Love that's not deserved, love that's not earned, love that is much like Jesus loved himself. That's the kind of love, that's the kind of life that makes a difference in the world around you. And Jesus says that's the kind of love that he shows as well. And the Apostle Paul, he kind of picked up on that same idea when he wrote to the church at Philippi. Because he said to them, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but consider others better than yourself. You see, Paul understood what Jesus was teaching all along. And he tried to get that point across. And there was one day when Jesus was teaching that same idea to his followers. And he was saying, now, I know what the world says about how life is best lived for self. When you look out for number one, when you're constantly considering what you need and finding your way to climb the ladder of success to get more and more and more for yourself. But he says that is very different from the kind of life that God designed you to live and the way that he designed you to spend your time. So Jesus tells the disciples, basically, that's what God is looking for. But the whole story actually begins back even a little earlier. It begins with the fact that the disciples still think that Jesus is going to institute an earthly kingdom. That they're on their way into Jerusalem right now so that Jesus can make up an army of all of the Jewish people. And it's the perfect time of year because it's coming right up on Passover. And all the Jewish men will be coming into town for Passover. And Jesus can raise up an army and he can take over the city of Jerusalem and kick out the corrupt Jewish government that's there and wipe out the Roman soldiers and all the occupying forces as well, and Jesus can take the throne of Israel and lead it the way it should be led. And oh, by the way, just as a kind of a secondary thought, all of us 12 disciples that have been traveling with Jesus all these years, we can expect some pretty good jobs in the new government, some positions of higher up authority, some positions of great honor, because we have been with Jesus all this time. There's only one problem, though, you know, because some positions of high authority have a little bit higher authority than others, don't they? Some positions of power are just a little bit more powerful. Some positions of honor have just a little bit more of honorableness to them. And who's going to get those greater positions? Who's going to be on top of the ladder of success? And who's going to be a couple rungs a little bit lower, you know? And really, there's only two really good positions in any kingdom. And that's the guy who sits at the right hand and the other guy who sits at the left hand of the king. Now, who's that going to be? Well, now, Peter, James, and John had to think that they probably were first on the list, you know, because those guys were the inner circles of the disciples. And when Jesus didn't take any of the other disciples with him somewhere, he always took Peter, James, and John. In fact, just earlier, back in the 9th chapter, you read about the time when Jesus went up on the Mount of Transfiguration and he transforms into his glorified state. And he's standing there between Elijah and Moses. And only Peter, James, and John were the three that got to see that. And they got to think, well, you know, we're pretty good shots for those two highest positions. But even that, you know, you got three guys and two positions. What are you going to do? And James and John figure out they know what they're going to do. Because after all, Peter will be selfish. And he will go to Jesus and he will ask for that right-hand seat or that left-hand seat himself, which is going to cut one of the two of us out. Peter will be real selfish and do that. And he shouldn't. So to keep him from doing it, we'll do it first. That makes sense, right? Okay, so we're not going to be selfish like Peter. We're going to keep him from being selfish by being selfish. So they get Jesus off by himself. They find him at a time when the others are not around. And they put their request in first to cut Simon Peter out of the circle there. Now Matthew goes into a little bit more detail here when he tells the story himself. He mentions that it wasn't just James and John doing it. They actually asked their mom to come along, you know. I mean, it's just the height of the wimp scale right here. They're going to ask their mom, would you go ask so that it doesn't look like it's coming from us? And plus, it's harder to say no to a woman than it is to a guy. So you go and you ask for us. And when Mark tells the story, he's a little bit more to the point. He knows who's really in charge here. So he starts off the story by saying that the two disciples said, Jesus, we want you to do something for us, whatever we ask. In other words, you just say yes, and then we'll tell you what you're saying yes to. Kind of like a kid saying to a parent, now I'm going to ask you something, but before I ask you, I want you to promise that you won't say no. Now there's a hook in there somewhere, and every good parent knows you never do that. I mean, it's almost like more of a congressional vote than a real request. You know, it's kind of like we have to vote on this bill and then we can pass it and then we'll tell you what's actually in it, you know. But Jesus knows what they're doing. And he knows that they're just looking out for themselves. And he knows that they have absolutely no idea what they're talking about. You know, what's funny is he's just offered the most detailed prediction of his death to them, and they're still thinking he's going to be an earthly king because they're not listening. Jesus is giving up his life, and they're doing everything they can to make their own lives better. He is going to a cross and they're trying to get a crown. He's going to suffer for them and they're going to try to make Simon Peter suffer so that they can celebrate themselves. And did you notice that neither of these two guys, or for that matter, any of the other disciples either, even bothered to ask Jesus about this whole prediction of his death? They never even bothered to say, Jesus, what do you mean you're going to die? Because they're not really concerned about Jesus. They're concerned about number one. They want to make sure that they get what they want. So Jesus basically is going to take care of the situation by asking them two questions and making a statement. And the two questions begin with this. Are you willing to drink the cup that I'm going to have to drink? Because it's a tougher cup than you think it is. The reality of it is that that's the very same cup that I'm going to ask my Father to let pass from me. Are you sure you want to drink it? Are you willing to be baptized with the baptism that I am undergoing? Are you willing to be completely submerged into the suffering I'm going to have to face and deal with? Is that really, really what you want? And with no idea what they're saying, they both say, yes, Lord, we are able. We can handle it. Just send it on our way. Now, they probably think that Jesus is talking about suffering that somebody else is going to have to do. And they're okay with that. They're probably thinking that Jesus says, well, we're going to have to go into battle here, and you're going to be a general, and you're going to have to be willing to send other people to die for you. Now, are you willing to do that? Are you willing to suffer so terribly in that manner? And the other guys say, yeah, it'll be tough, Lord, but we can handle it. But in reality, that's not what Jesus is saying at all. Then he makes a statement. He says, that place on my right and my left hand, those have been reserved for someone else. He says, don't worry, there's going to be plenty of suffering to go around for everyone, but you're mistaken about the right and left side, because actually there's going to be two thieves there when I come into my kingdom. And they won't be sitting on thrones, they'll be hanging from crosses just like me. And don't worry, there's plenty of crosses to go around. Indeed, when they understand better, they will see firsthand what Jesus is talking about. Because did you know that James, in AD 44, becomes the first of all the disciples to be killed because they're following Jesus? And John, he's actually the last. He has to suffer through a lifetime of watching his friends die one by one in horrible, horrible ways. He has to be tortured again and again and again until he finally dies an old man, decrepit and beaten down by the torture that he had to go through so many years. And yeah, they would drink the cup. They would be baptized with the baptism. You know, the funny thing is, even though they're talking to Jesus privately, somehow the word gets out. You know, it always does. You can't have a conversation with somebody without the word getting out what you've been talking about. And as soon as the other disciples, the other 10 guys, hear what James and John have done, they absolutely go ballistic. The Bible says they become indignant with them. They are so angry. You know why they're angry? Because they feel like they have been sold out. They feel like they've been betrayed. How horrible that is must have Matthew thought. This is just like the Gentiles who worked with me when I was a tax collector. How terrible James and John are, Simon Peter must have thought, to be willing to sell me out that way. Judas Iscariot thinks that these guys are acting unethically. Now let me tell you something, guys. If you can get Judas Iscariot mad at you because he thinks that you've been selling somebody out, you've really done something here, okay? Because Judas Iscariot is indignant with them because he thinks they're acting unethically. So Jesus has to take all 10 of them, and James and John as well, aside. And pretty much he tells them, guys, the main reason that you're mad with these two is because you didn't come up with the idea first. You're probably just jealous, thinking, why didn't I ask my mom to come and talk to Jesus about this kind of thing? The reality of it is that none of these guys are any better than James and John. They've all been constantly fighting over who is the greatest in the kingdom. Every one of them had some reason to believe that they should be sitting in that right seat, or at least the left. In fact, before all this went down, Jesus knew that they had been arguing over who was going to get for themselves the very best seats. And no one is in the least concerned about anyone other than themselves. They've missed basically everything that Jesus has taught them in the 3 years he spent with them. So he sits them down for a long talk. And he points out that in their culture, the Gentiles who are running their land, the Romans, the ones that they are hoping Jesus will get rid of soon, he says, you're acting just like them. Because they have this social hierarchy where there are important people and unimportant people. Where there are powerful people that set the standard of how valuable or how meaningless you are according to how much authority you carry. And he says in that world, in the Gentiles' world, the higher-ups kind of lord it over the people like us, and they push other people around, and they make regular people serve their needs and wants. They're very selfish, and you want me to get rid of them. So here's a question for you. You hate this system so bad, why do you want to be like them? You know what? Our world is not really all that different from the world of the Romans in that day. We've got the same thing going on. We have a hierarchy of power and authority. There are some people who matter and some people who don't, according to the world standards, even in our world today. There are a lot of politicians who like the system that way. They have the power to feel like they can do whatever they want, to get whatever they want, no matter who it hurts. So it's okay for them to go ahead and lie because the people that they're lying to are not as valuable as they are. In fact, they're pretty much meaningless. And in our world, we celebrate people and give them authority for no other reason than that somebody somewhere said that they are celebrities. I mean, is there any other explanation for why we all know who the Kardashians are than just somebody said, hey, these people are important, let's put them on television? And we beg people like this to tell us their opinions so we know what we're supposed to think. And many times even Christians live according to society's hierarchy as to who's important and who's not. And wherever you fall on that list, chances are most of us are trying to get just a little higher. Maybe it's at work, or maybe trying to be a little bit better known in the community. And chances are good that someone's right behind you trying to take your place. So again, Jesus looks at us and asks the same question. Why do you want to live like that? Why do you want to constantly be looking for yourself and to raise your own status rather than to meet the needs of others? Because you will never be important in this world as long as you're trying to be important in this world. So he said to the disciples, the only way to truly matter is to show other people that they matter. If you really want to be great, find a way to be a servant. The greatest of all is the slave of all. And that's not a hypothetical idea that we should all seemingly attain to and try to grab that attitude for ourselves. This is actually a call to action. This means that we ought to be doing things, not just thinking a certain way, but actually acting a certain way. This is a call to become slaves to the people that the world would say are not much worth the trouble. A call to count ourselves as less important than them. In effect, Jesus is saying to his disciples, if you want the kind of greatness that you keep arguing about, the kind of greatness that you keep looking for, the kind of greatness that looks for the right and the left seats in the kingdom, the kind that holds on to what it has and refuses to give it up for people that you think is not as important as you, then you need to join the Gentiles and work your way up in their ranks and be important in their eyes. But if you want true meaning, if you want God to think you're important, then give up what is meaningful to you so that you can be meaningful to others. There's this book that was written by Gail D. Irwin. It's called The Jesus Style. And in that book, he describes servanthood this way. Is a quote. A servant's job is to do all he can to make life better for others, to free them to be everything that they can be. A servant's first interest is not in himself, but in others. Servanthood is a loving choice that we make to minister to others. When I was growing up, my best friend was a San Francisco 49ers fan. Now, this was before they actually got good. You know, this is in the years long before Joe Montana came along, when the quarterback there was a guy by the name of John Brody. And he talked about Brody all the time. And I didn't realize something, but Brody was one of the best quarterbacks in the NFL during those years. He started playing quarterback for the Niners back in the late 50s and played all the way through the 60s and even some into the 70s. And almost every year, he led the league in touchdown passes and completion percentages. He led the league one year in the lowest rate of interceptions. One year, 1970, he was chosen as the most valuable player for the entire NFL. He was impressive. But you know what else he did? John Brody was not just a multi-million dollar quarterback. He also was the guy that received long snaps on the field. In other words, he was the guy that sat down on one knee and he waited for the football to be hiked back to him maybe 10 yards back and he'd catch it and then he'd put his finger on it and hold it for the kicker to kick the ball if there was an extra point or if there was a field goal. Okay, so he holds the ball so the kicker can kick it. Have you ever done that? Anybody here ever hold the ball so somebody else can kick it? Anybody ever get your hand kicked by a guy with a leg the size of Louisiana? I mean, because those guys can kick hard and they will sometimes catch your hand. That's his throwing hand. And somebody said, that's a stupid job for you to do. You're a multi-million dollar contract. You are the guy who throws more touchdown passes than anybody else in the NFL. And yet you take this job. Why do you hold the ball for the kicker? And Brody's answer was, because if I don't hold it, it'll fall over. Now that makes sense. I like that. Because you see what he's saying is, it's really not about me taking care of me. It's about me holding the ball to keep it from falling over so the team can get ahead. It's about me looking out for the needs of other people, not just myself. I wonder, is there anything in your life that would fall over if you weren't holding it? Is there anything in your life that you're serving other people that you hold on to so that other people don't have to? Like, for instance, if you've ever thought about serving in the church nursery, are there kids that will literally fall over unless you're in there to hold them? I wonder if you've got a friend who's going through a particularly tough time. If you're not there to hold them, are they going to fall over? You know, again, our world tends to think of some people as important and some not. Do you serve those that the rest of the world says is not worth your time? The people that we tend to not even think of as people. That girl at the drive-thru who messes up your order. You know something about her that you might not know? She is a human being. And human beings make mistakes all the time. Do you become angry at her because there's a pickle on your burger when you said no pickles? Does the tone get nasty because you have to say, no, I'm sorry, I said regular Coke, not Diet Coke? Boy, that really gets on my nerves a lot of times. I don't tell you. Sometimes you're preaching to the choir. Sometimes you're preaching to the pulpit. That is mine today. Do you get mad and nasty at people when they make mistakes because you're more important than they are? Do you use a paper towel? I don't know if you do this or not, but if I go to the restroom and I've got to open the doorknob, you get a paper towel to open the doorknob because you know that the guy that was in there before you has, all over his hand and you don't want to touch that doorknob. So, you wash your hands and you've got your hands all clean and you don't want to touch that doorknob. So you get a paper towel and you open the doorknob and then you throw it over at the trash can and sometimes you miss. And I'm not going to go back over there and touch that wet now dirty paper towel that's on the floor. Somebody else can do that. That's somebody else's job because I'm too important for that. I'm too big to serve. You know, it's interesting. Jesus doesn't tell these guys that they won't have authority. He says, James and John, you're going to have authority. I just want to know how you're going to use it. Because the pagans use whatever authority they can find for their own benefit to turn the spotlight on themselves. They choose the fishing rod over the bed jacket every time. Not going to make somebody else happy. I know what I want. I have what I want, and I'll keep what I have. So if you have some position, do you use it to further yourself or to bless others? And guess what? Everybody here has some position. You have some authority over someone somewhere. Someone is watching you to see what they should do, to see if they are important in your eyes. Maybe your position is as a parent. You're a father. You're a mother. You have authority over your children. Do you use it to further yourself or to be a blessing to the world that's coming up behind you? Maybe you're an employee, or you're an employer, or maybe you're just the guy that's sitting at the stoplight next to a car, and he's looking over to you to see if you're important, too important to let him pull in front of you because he really needs to get in your lane. Somewhere, sometime, you have authority over somebody. Do you use it for self, or do you show love? Because that's what Jesus did. He showed love. You remember just earlier he had predicted his death? Well, at the end of this whole statement, he's going to tell them why. He says, the Son of Man didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus says, I will reach my highest moment of honor on a cross, not on a throne. I will give my life to buy you back. I will give up what I think is precious, my own life, my own innocence, because you need me to buy you back. Well, you need to have purchased back your life and your eternity. You need me to make you clean again. And the amazing thing is, Jesus is the one individual in all of creation's history who really could honestly look down on others as lesser beings, and he didn't do that. We are not as valuable as he. The Bible tells us we deserved our fate, but in love, Jesus was willing to be unselfish, to literally lay down his life to give us what we needed most. And he didn't even ask us to deserve it first. And that, to me, is never-ending amazing. Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So if you are a follower of this king, I certainly do not blame you if you want to be on his right or left side. I do too. I want to be as close to him as I possibly can. But if you want to be close to Jesus, you need to remember that it's a cross that you'll be hanging off of, not a throne you'll be sitting on. It's a place to lay down your life, not take it up. If you are a follower of this king, you need to do what he did and look for ways to serve rather than to be served. You need to look for what is precious in your life, your time, your money, your relationships, your status in the community, and you need to be willing to trade that for bed jackets because the world really needs someone to love them that much. The world really needs someone who will heal the hearts of others, other people that the world tells us has no value. If you're a follower of this king, you need to live like him. And if you're not a follower of this king, you really need to be. Because you can't lay down your life until you have life. And according to Jesus, according to the scriptures, if you haven't found life in him, you're not living. You're still dead in your sins. And you need to accept the gift of life that he offers you today. There will never be a better moment to live forever than this moment right now. So as we do each week, we offer a time of invitation here. A time when you can make a decision to follow after Jesus. A time when you can say, I want the life that lasts forever that Jesus offers to me. So would you stand with me, and at this time we're going to sing our song of invitation. And if you have any decision to make, why don't you come forward as we sing.
Here I am.
It's good to have everyone here today. Be sure to look at the back of the bulletins. There are several prayer requests on there. We have a few that's been added to it today. So, Jeremy Hall, this is Misty Curry's brother, had gallbladder surgery. They removed the polyp, so they've got to send that off, so keep him in your prayers. Doyle Tungate is having hip surgery on November the 4th. This is Mary Pepper's nephew. Barbara Moore, she has a broken back and is in a lot of pain, so remember her. And also we need to remember, pray for the Ford family, so please keep all these in your prayers. Let's go to and close with a word of prayer. Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, God, for this time that we could come out and worship and praise your name, God. God, we just we know that you know all the prayer requests, God, but we ask that you would add a special blessing on those who've been turned in here this morning for special prayer requests. God, we ask just now that you guide us and guard us in our ways home. Give us a good week, and we ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen. Yeah.